All right, so tonight, I'm just realizing, you can see my t-shirt says Damned in the blade. I'm gonna start working on this Greaves. It's a near wedge grind. Show a couple of photos. Already where you see the bevel and edge is destroyed up at the toe. All right, so basically, this is a big blade. Measures about 15/16 up at the toe. I'm going to lose dimension on this, but that's fine. I put a layer of tape on here because it's a heavy grind. I know I'm going to be pulling the edge back. I'm not certain that I'm going to have an ideal bevel angle when I'm done. If I don't and I have to drop it, then I'll continue honing without tape. It was honed originally, or at one time, well, without tape. I could see the flat up in the spine. It seems to be polished over though, and the blade in general has an awful lot of shine to it, which I think is a little unusual for something that has like all this damage at the toe. But who knows? Maybe somebody cleaned it up so they could sell it. Don't really know. What I know is this: I like Greaves razors, and I've been feeling like getting a new one. So I picked this up, knowing that I'm going to have some work to do. Now, I'm going to be doing a rolling stroke here, which is kind of why I have the camera facing in. All right? Because if I just do my normal work, right, I'm probably not going to be cleaning up the toe so easily. And you can see that there's a smile. And I really want to sort of keep that contour. So I'm gonna, it's a Shapton 1.5K, 1500X. And I just put it down so it's taking on a little water, so I have to watch that. All right. I'm not really into it yet, the honing, I mean. I'm gonna have to stop and do some inspection with my 10X loop. And the roll I was talking about is a little bit, you can see that, right? I just come up like a little bit. So what I want to do is I want to follow the edge around this curve. I'm gonna have to hone up into those breaks that you saw, those chips. And try and make as clean a bevel as I can. I got this for a shaver, not a looky-loo. So if it doesn't come out with like this perfectly smooth line, I'm gonna be all right. You can really see the blade come up a little bit, just a little bit. Do the same here. See? Just trying to match it on both sides. And what I'm going to do, see, after I do a little bit of this, I'm going to stop and I'm going to go take a look at. Now you see, I'm not really catching. Let me put some water over there so you can see a little better. That over here. All right. I'm not really hitting to the heel so well, so I'm gonna wind up having to do like a full roll, I think. I could hone straight up into it. I don't know if you could see that, and then sort of flatten everything out, and it would make honing a whole lot more straightforward. Now, can you see the rocking motion? I don't really need to do a whole lot. It's a pretty effective stone, so I'm pretty sure I'll see where I'm hitting. I'm starting with blade up a little bit. I have blade pushed forward, light torque, some torque, maybe medium torque. I'm not like really driving, right? And I start off riding right here at the heel. All right, and as I'm doing that, then I continue forward. It's dry as heck in here. Might be a little easier for you to see if I keep it really wet. So maybe if I stop talking while I'm showing, and you can just see it. Having a little bit of trouble catching right up to the very heel on my forward stroke. So what I'm going to want to do, I want to try change my heel forwardness. There we go. See how the undercut rides like right across the blade? Well, it does when I'm not talking and trying to look at the monitor. I have a mirror behind the camera, no, iPhone. And trying to watch that to make sure that what I'm trying to show is coming across. Now, what I'm doing here, I'm not pushing down, I'm steering. I'm using this finger and these two fingers, I'm pivoting. Now, granted, this takes a little bit of practice, but once you get it, it comes pretty natural. First couple of times, like you bobble it, you screw shit up, whatever, it doesn't matter, don't worry about it. Let's go take a look and see what we got. Okay, so we're back. And we're going to do some honing now. For real. So, you saw on the still photos, in between these two clips, I'm trying to get my fingers out of the way and it's not working, so. You saw that the honing, a little bit of honing I had done, had started to show the bevel, the new bevel that I'll be cutting into this razor. Actually, a little harder for me to do than I had thought it was going to be, because I usually hone on like this little bit of an angle, and I'm out by the sink, and but I'm not trying to make excuses, just a new way to do stuff, and trying to get my rhythm in sync with my muscle memory. Once I get the feel down, I can stop relying on my other hand. It gets a little easier for me to do the roll. I'm losing the extra feedback from my guide finger, but mostly what I was trying to do was sense this area up in here where it's chewed up. It's like sawteeth. Make sure I was hitting, not ripping up steel and leaving it under the blade and stuff. You can do this any way you want. That's just what I do. Sometimes I come right out of the gate doing it one-handed. Sometimes I hone the entire time using a guide hand. I don't do that so much anymore. I do a little bit of it. Usually after I catch myself doing that, switch over to one hand. Now, remember, I'm torquing in a little bit. There's a little bit of rock. I think what might happen is I might be able to back off my roll at the heel a little bit to see how it pans out. You know, I know a lot of guys show bevel setting clips and what have you. You know, they show you nice pretty new razors, and chances are most of them have probably honed it before they get it on camera. So what they're showing you is sort of a truncated or abbreviated version of reality. You know, a lot of the blades I buy are damaged in some way. A couple of reasons for that. One, often you can get a really nice razor like this Greaves, you know, at a good price or cheaper price. Because Well, people are afraid of that, you know, that stuff going on up at the top. You know. The other thing is, you know, if you buy a brand new razor, or you buy something that's, you know, you've been hauled or whatever, and, you know, that's fine. But so far as learning how to hone goes, you don't learn so much from that. Right? That little swoop, you know, you don't really have to do that to a Dovo Best. We shouldn't have to. Guess what I'm getting at is it's a little bit harder, it's more of a challenge, it's more work, it's more effort, you know, but the rewards are higher to me. You know, if guys buy, you know, gold dollars, you know, the toughest thing about a gold dollar is getting your Dremel out to grind off the stabilizer and shoulder. You know, after that, there's no big deal. I mean, the steel's not that hard, and as long as it's not incredibly warped, all you have to do is spend a little extra time evening out like that really shitty grind they give you. But, you know, you got a DMT that goes in like no time. DMT or a 400 stone, good one. I mean, you know, when people buy like 50 of them, oh, I hold 50 razors. Well, it's like holding the same razor 50 times. It's whatever. It's that, that's what floats your boat, then that's great. At the end of the day, you put in that time, you put in that money. Me, personally, I'd rather spend 50 bucks on an old Sheffield, clean it up. See if I can see that chewed up part. And, you know, even if it takes like a ridiculous amount of time, you know, to clean up the geometry, when I'm done, I got a piece of history. You know? I don't have some piece of shit made in a Chinese communist freaking sweatshop. Fucking countries looking to, like, oh yeah, they're our friends. My ass. Okay? You want to spend your money in China, fine. Just saying. You know? Who am I supporting here? That's just the way I look at it. You know, sometimes you can't get away from it. Swivel hooks that I buy from my drops. Cannot find them made in the United States. I thought I found somebody. I have to follow up with an email. He said it could help me out. He manufactures hardware, but, you know, it's like the first one in like a year and a half. But anyway. Now, I have a good amount of pressure, okay? I mean, a real good amount of pressure. I'm really torqued in. I don't know how many pounds of pressure. I don't have a PSI meter. Don't even have a pizza scale. I don't even know what a pizza scale is. Anyway, it's a private joke. I have a bathroom scale once I used to, see if I could get 32 pounds of pressure on a blade when I was honing, because this genius on the shaving form said it couldn't be done. The guy's continually talking at his ass. So I got up from my computer, went into the bathroom, put a stone on it, and lo and behold, I had 35 pounds of pressure. It was uncomfortable, but it was doable. Wouldn't do it with a full hollow. Could probably get away with it, you know, on a blade like this. You can still twist a wedge, though. Believe it. Doing a little concentration work up here at the top. And then you see, as I continue, I'm putting more and more of the blade up onto the stone. And do another sequence of it. So basically what I'm doing, I'm working on the blade sort of in stages. When I get to a safe point, what I'm going to do is I'm going to even it all out. This is a little loaded. It's one of the downsides of honing hard like this. You're driving the swarf into the surface of your stone. But, you know, they're just tools. It happens. If you're looking for a synth that doesn't load when you set bevel on a wedge, yeah, I don't know, man. It's like fucking Disneyland shit. Not happening. Unless maybe you're fucking Pinocchio and you know Geppetto or something. I may hone this blade over a couple of days, but this stage I want to do start to finish. After I get bevel, or at least if I have cleared that obnoxious stuff up at the toe, I can give it a rest. But until then, I really need my muscle memory to be like 110%. Starting to get some good undercut in the first third of the blade past the heel. You know, I'm going to take a couple of breaks here and there. Let me take a look at this right now on my loop. Yeah, I got a ton of work here. I mean, seriously. And a lot of people would probably opt to handle this another way, like they would want to do a reprofile on a stone or a DMT to sort of like a bread knife or something like that. And in many ways that makes a lot of sense, you know, because you can just get everything like, you know, straight. Then you know what you're working with. At the same time, I kind of like to sneak up on stuff. You know, it's a 15/16 blade, thereabouts. Might have been an 8/8 at one time. You know, I don't want to take off even a 64th of an inch more than I have to. As it is, I'm going to be exaggerating the smile up to the cut here in the barber's notch. And, you know, I could put it on a 400. I have a 400X Chaucera. And it would go a little faster. But it's the same kind of thing. You know, I don't want to overshoot if I don't have to. I know from experience what's going to happen. There's like this one chip in that, like, that strip up by the toe. It's like, it's terrible. And I have to bring the edge up to the apex of that chip. And the last little bit that last like, you know, get up into it, it'll go pretty quick. It seems like you go through, you know, into a chip, you go like 2/3 of the way, you feel like, wow, this isn't so bad. Then you have that last third. And the first part slows down and you're like, oh, what the hell's going on? Is my stone still cutting? You know? And it's progress, but it's not like, it doesn't seem like it did before. Then you get to like the last 10% of that thing, and it's like it just won't go away. It'll make you nuts. And I think that's why a lot of guys opt for like really aggressive methods. Because, you know, it gets really frustrating. Well, it can get really frustrating, you know, if you let it get to you. I know what I'm dealing with going in here. I had a bigger chip. Similar type of thing, but a bigger chip on an old GR, George's Reign, Wade and Butcher. And I think I spent, geez, like 2 hours grinding away at that blade. I triple beveled it because it was a wedge and I just had to thin out, you know, some steel so I could get in there and not have some ridiculous bevel angle. You know, ridiculously fat one. And, yeah, I gotta tell you, that one really strained the limits of my patience. I was just, wow, why is this taking so long? And I started that one on a 400 too, but when I start on the 400, I don't go all the way. I'll go like 80% of the way, and then I'll finish up with the next finest stone, so again, I don't overshoot. You know, it's a numbers game. 32nd of an inch of edge width, blade width, rather. That can really make a change in things. You know, not too long from now, I'm going to have to change the tape. Because what happens is this, it wears and it compresses. So you wind up like not having exactly the same angle at the stone. And the good news is I'm getting in some good undercut. Another part of the story is this, and this is like a beautiful part of honing a damaged wedge. When you're done clearing chips and whatever else is going on out, you are almost guaranteed to be sitting in fresh steel, good steel. A lot of them, you know, have been stored in damp places and they get like micro pitting. And you hone it and the bevel looks great and you progress forward, then all of a sudden you have edge fail. This goes on, it goes on, you send it to a friend, he has the same thing, some people throw them out, they're like, I don't know what's going on. Nah, it's micro-pitting, man. You gotta cut past that, you gotta get into good steel. It's one of the reasons I avoid a full hollow that has, you know, any type of noticeable devil spit or rust up into the bevel. I just don't want it. I've had full hollows with rust goes clear through the bevel. I could see daylight. Yeah, it's true. It happens. Had it happen on a wedge, too. Oh, God, that sucked. I just had to, like, hone. I did it over, like, a long period of time. It was a nice blade, and I had to lose so much edge width. Excuse me, keep saying that wrong. Blade width. It was just, like, a shame. All right, what I'm going to do now... go take another photo and then insert that pick into the finished product right after this clip, and then, you know, I'll come back, retape the edge, and then keep going a little bit. I don't know how much of this back and forth I want to keep showing you because, well, you know, it gets boring. At some point I'm going to cut it out and take a pick of the bevel up by the toe, and you know, hopefully this gives you an idea of what you're dealing with. All right, so I'm back now. And you just saw the photo that I took after the last session. And you saw the bevel developing, you know. Basically, the geometry is starting to come along. Needs a lot of work. I feel like I'm in a good place. And I'm getting really trying to catch it. You can see the tape is still intact, but there's wear, okay? You don't have to get out a caliper. You know there's wear. It's been on an abrasive stone, okay? So at some point, well, several some points along the way, what I'm going to have to do, right, is put some more tape on, change it. Now, if I was worried about, you know, the width of the bevel, excuse me while I pause here, because trying to get it even on both sides. Now, two things I want to do here. I want to trim this here. All right. Because I don't want it past here. All right. I have enough hollow here where I really don't have to sweat the evenness of the tape, but if there was any less grind, I would have to be uber careful. Still have to be kind of careful because you can mess up, because what happens is the tape comes down too far on one side and you wind up sort of changing the angle a little bit. I mean, nobody ever dies from that. It's just one of those things you don't want to do if you don't have to. I suppose you could screw up a razor, but you know, the razors we're shaving here, you know, we're not, you know, flying rockets to the moon, so we have to be careful, but we don't have to be nuts. So, you know, if I was worried about the width of the bevel, you know, to any great degree, what I would have done is use two pieces, but two pieces of tape, you know, it just compounds things. Yeah, it makes, you know, a nice tight bevel in there, changes the angle. I don't want stubby. I want, you know, as acute an angle as possible. I want the steeper bevel. My experience with greaves are is that I don't have to worry about dropping even down to 15 degrees. I'll be fine. I can go below it. You know, people say, oh, you got to have 17, whatever. No, you just have to have, like, what works. And like I said, I'm dealing with unknowns here. A lot of unknowns. I can see how much work needs to be done at a minimum, but I don't know what's going to happen as I go along. I don't really know how it's going to shape up. I have a picture in my mind's eye, but it's just a picture. Reality will be what it is when I get to that point. If you saw that photo, that chip that is on the side away from the toe, closer to the heel, it's not huge, but it's significant. And it's up into the thicker part of the bevel. And it's going to cost me some time, some effort. It's going to cost me some steel. And I'm just going to hope that as I'm going along, I wind up not having any black spots showing up on the bevel, because that can happen too. And then you got to hone past that and so on and so forth. Now I'm back doing a little bit of a roll here. I looked at the bevel now under a loop. The very top part of the bevel is probably not hitting the stone because the tape before it compressed. Now I'm back up, so my angle's a little steeper now than it was when I was ending. The reason this all winds up working out okay is because when you get to the end, you can pretty much wipe out any irregularity pretty quickly. Get through the whole session without needing to change tape. As long as you start it on fresh tape. And, you know, and then as I'm honing each stone, each successive grit, I'll change the tape again. Might change it a few times on 3K also. It depends on how much work I gotta do. But after that, I'm usually good, and it's like once per stone, per grit, or whatever. I can actually pretty much get through a full Nagura progression on one piece of tape. And I don't want to tell you, I hate using it. I really do. I just don't want to put a big ugly flat on the spine on this thing while I'm figuring stuff out. I've had a lot of blades like this, and I just love shaving with them. If I set this up on one piece of tape and I think it's a little too stout, stubby, obtuse, whatever. Talking about the bevel angle, yeah. Yeah, I'll take the tape off and then hone without it. It takes like really no time to readjust that angle. There's a lot of hysteria on the forums about, you know, tape, no tape. And I don't know why people get all wrapped up in that shit. Use it if you want to. Don't if you don't. Please don't tell me I'm damaging the razor by doing it. It's all bullshit. I'm damaging the razor. Did you see the toe on this thing? Go yell at the asshole who used this thing to open up a freaking cardboard box. Tell him he damaged it. I put tape on it. You're telling me I'm damaging it. Such ridiculous crap. Okay. So right now, the chip, the apex, the top of the chip has moved away from the shinogi considerably. And I'm in the first third of that correction. I'm going to go back to using two hands because I feel like it. And I don't care what the poobahs say or think. No, I really don't. When I first started honing, I used to read. I'd be up till 2, 3 o'clock in the morning reading thread after thread, going through the archives of every forum I could get opened up and search the old posts and the new posts. Go through everything. Find somebody who sounded like they knew what they were talking about. Go check out every post they've ever done. You know, then you find somebody who's got 15,000 posts. So you're not really going too far with that unless you have a lot of free time. But I read all this stuff and be like, it really can't be that finite, you know? It can't be that scary. It can't be so mysterious. All I'm doing is like rubbing a blade on a rock, for crying out loud. What I'm doing now is I'm picking up my roll a little bit. I'm exaggerating a little bit at the heel over what I need. I'd rather have a little bit of a wider bevel there. And I'll tell you why. What I want is for the metal to be either, I just grabbed my finger. I want it to be like, as parallel as possible. I don't want the edge width to swell up at the toe because I'm afraid, or I'm scared of, I don't want that, okay, because it gets in the way of the edge. People miss that. To me, I don't mind a little tiny bit of extra wear there, just enough to make that edge width like parallel. Now, because I can't be perfect, I'm okay with a little bit of extra thinness up in that area. It's not really the edge width I'm talking about. I guess I'm talking about the shinogi line thickness, that dimension that runs along here. If you can imagine, like, if the metal swelled up and got fatty here, it would sit on the stone like crooked. If it's perfectly even, then it sits flat. And if it's a little thin, it still sits flat, but there's a little gap. I'd rather have the gap than the tilt the other way. That's all I'm saying. By repeated sessions of concentration, of effort to the toe, I gain a little bit. I have to be careful. I have to make sure that the blade is basically like kind of sitting flat and I'm not like driving into the stone like, you know, like this, all right? And maybe if I move this forward, you catch me back here. All right. Yeah, the count is only so wide, so I can only get the camera back so far. I needed space between the camera and the wall so I can put a mirror up there and allows me to check the monitor. Sorry if I went off camera a couple of times, but making videos is not my strong point. Which is funny, because I think there's like 60 of them on my channel now. I dream someday about doing like a three-camera thing with like a full-blown editing and like some kind of effects and like, you know, I don't know, maybe some kind of talent on camera helping me out and make it all very polished and very slick. And then like I wake up and I realize I'm not that kind of guy. But it would be kind of cool to have, in a way, it would be kind of cool to have some sort of Hollywood type of thing going on, I guess. Or maybe I could like partner with someone else in the industry, set up some kind of storyline where branch across a couple of different disciplines, show the interweaving, the symbiotic nature, like maybe like, you know, a guy who makes a razor and then honing it the first time, something like that, I don't know. Anyway, I think about that stuff, but I never have the time to even start to pursue it. I'm working a little bit on the heel here. I'm losing a little bit of my smoothness. I gotta pay attention. Kind of getting a little bored, also getting a little hungry. So like I'm sitting here and I'm honing, I'm talking to you and I'm thinking about getting a pizza, which is a crying shame because like my girl left me with like this wonderful roast that she made before she went on a trip. And she's like the best girl in the world, man. She knows I'm going to be like tied up with all kinds of stuff, and she left me with all types of foods that she cooked, and you know, she's out in the wilds of Wisconsin right now doing her thing. I got all that beautiful food in there, and all I can think about is a freaking pizza. I think I'll be eating the food she made, because as much as I love pizza, it's not even going to touch what she did with that roast. Anyway, it's about home, not eating pizza. So my undercut is like kind of okay. It's a little better on the return stroke at the heel than it is on the forward stroke. So I know I have to work a little bit more there. It's okay. You know, that comes back like pretty quick. It's just a matter of paying attention. You know, if I was like really concerned, I could do a couple of quick half strokes.